In 1939, world attention was focused on Europe, where Nazi Germany executed its plan for world domination. With the world preoccupied in Europe, Japan quietly planned its goals for expanding its empire. Japan was already at war with China, but few in the West knew just how strong Japan had grown. After attacking Pearl Harbor on Sunday, December 7, 1941, Japan advanced quickly and was on the doorstep of India within a few months. Surrounded by India and China, Burma is a land filled with thick jungles, desert plains, and mountaintops reaching 20,000 feet. This battlefront has received as little attention today as it did 60 years ago. Of the 8,000 Canadians that fought in Burma from 1942 to 1945, few remain to tell their stories.
Burma is, they've often called it, the Forgotten War. Lord Louis Mountbatten actually told us that we weren't forgotten. They didn't even know we were there in the first place. And there was a big, big army out there.
Basically, the war out in Burma was almost non-reported back in Canada.
In fact, my mother and dad didn't know anything about it until, this is strange, one night she woke my dad up and said, "I think Ted's in trouble."
We were forgotten.
From the independent kingdom of Nepal came the Gurkhas. From the Naga Hills, Naga headhunters joined forces with the Allies. From East Africa and West Africa came more troops. From Burma came the Burma Rifles. And from the Chin Hills, Chin and Kachin tribesmen. Scots, Irish, English, Welsh, Australian, New Zealander, Indian, Gurkha, Burman, African, Chinese, American. Never was there such a polyglot army.
You have to understand that even the war started in Europe in 1939. There was literally no front in the Far East. Japan had conquered Manchuria and a part of China. But that was only the beginning. That was the early part of the war. But the Allies didn't think that Japan was any threat. So when Japan invaded a part of China, China fought the Japanese, and so China became part of the Allied group. The British were trying to get the Americans into the war far before 1941. But when in 1941 Pearl Harbor took place, and America declared war, then it was that the Japanese decided on broadening their empire. So the proper war in Burma didn't start till 1942. But there were probably 500,000 to 600,000 Japanese troops in Burma by then. And the idea was to get into Assam, which is the northern part of India.
Then they turned towards Burma, and their idea was to take the whole of the Malay Peninsula, plus Burma and India. But just like Hitler, they wanted world domination.
They were so clever, and they worked so quickly that they began the move. They got right down to the Indian border.
Well, if the Japanese had broken through into India, there was a group of people that were going to join them. Okay, and then they would have wiped the British out of India.
Churchill then realized that something had to be done with the Burma campaign to stop the Japanese from taking over. And this is where much of the supplies, the Air Force, the Army, the Navy was sent out to the Far East to get the Japanese out.
Japan moved quickly after the attack on Pearl Harbor. They proceeded to capture Hong Kong, Manila, Indochina, Malaysia, Thailand, Singapore, and finished by capturing Burma in May of 1942. Burma's terrain posed new challenges for those who were involved. Few could foresee the difficulties of fighting along this front.
Yeah, conditions were pretty bad most of the time, but you got used to them and you learned learn to look after yourself, I think, to a great degree. Malaria was the big bugaboo, the thing worried most people.
I got malaria, and I've had malaria ever since, and I still get it.
The heat was sometimes about 40 degrees Celsius. The rain, the mud, the malaria, the fever, this was a greater danger to the troops there than anything else.
I got sick in India. I got jaundice and dysentery. I lost 60 pounds in the first month I was in India and never gained it back. I arrived there 180 pounds, and I spent most of my time there at 120 pounds. So I was thin and slim at that time. I'm thinking of going back to get rid of some of the extra weight I'm carrying now.
And I was there in 1945, and what we were doing mainly then was taking ferrying supplies across from the coast to the airfields on the far side of the Irrawaddy, but with the occasional supply drop. I had two supply drops, which were kind of dicey dudes because of the weather conditions. As you can appreciate, we were there from about the May until October of night of the year, and that is the height of the monsoon season. You really got little idea what the monsoon is and that season is unless you've been in a continuous heavy rainstorm. You might be interested to know that in this particular area we would get 400 inches of rain a year, the large percentage of which would fall between these months of May and October.
Everything was damp, moldy. You never really dried out. There's no place to dry out. We had two runways. The runway was a pile of sand with metal interlocking steel sitting on top of the sand. That was the runway.
Rivulets would form and take the sand out, and the first aircraft that came in after this bad rain would be okay, but unfortunately the pierced steel plating would give way under the weight of the aircraft because there's nothing supporting it when the rivulets had taken the sand away. And two great spikes would be setting up, and you had to wait until this had been straightened out before you could come back in again.
Chinese troops trained by Americans pushed through jungles and across rivers in the Allied reconquest of northern Burma from the Japs. Here they're in the drive for the city of Ba Mo, an important highway center. The Japs, though abandoning most of northern Burma, defend Ba Mo stubbornly, and there's a 28-day siege by the Chinese. Land of pagodas in the grip of modern war, and Buddha, oriental and inscrutable, with bullet holes.
Whether it was flying supplies over the mountains, at war on the seas of the Indian Ocean, or trudging the depths of the Burma jungle, Canadian stories vary as much as the landscape.
My crew and I were fortunate. We got off and did five trips in one day. And when we landed on the fifth time, the Indian major who was in charge of the airport, the airfield, said, "Norm, this is the first time anybody has ever done five trips. This deserves a drink." I said, "You're damn right." So we piled in his jeep and went around to his quarters. And what did he do but bring out a big bottle of brandy? Wow. First drink we'd had for a long time. I had, I suppose, more of this than I should have done, because got back to the airfield and all the aircraft were lined up. I taxied out. And so I and my partially drunken state stuck my head out and said, "I can't see any damn clouds." And I pulled ahead, went off and took off. And at 200 feet, of course, I hit cloud. Well, again, my experience in instrument flying came in good stead. And I did a few tight circuits and got the height above any surrounding hills and hightailed off for Batavia. I had a good reason for doing this, because I had a Dutch lady friend there who had been shown to be in dire need of some male company. And I was certainly in the stage where I was happy to give it. And so I didn't want to disappoint Molly and not get back. We lost one of our fellows. He committed suicide, a poor kid. He was only a youngster, about 18 or something. I think he just got fed up with everything and turned a rifle on himself.
We went in, five destroyers went in against a heavy cruiser called the Hagira in the Malacca Straits. And they're big ships. They carry 10 8-inch guns, which can fire 17 miles. We only carry 4.7s, which can fire 7 miles. So we should have been blown out of the water. But they made some mistakes, and we got in close enough to fire torpedoes at her. And we fired 40 torpedoes and hit her 11 times. And she went down with a huge loss of life.
This was a trip that I was flying with another crew. They were short, and I needed a trip. And so I joined this crew. And as before we got on, there was this other Canadian, and he was from the prairies. And we decided that we would go and get a cup of tea before we got on board. So he didn't have any money. So I remember I paid for it. He said, "I'll pay you when we get back." So anyway, I go down, and he was the navigator, and he'd been sitting now the nose of the gun. It has a guns up front, and they would feed along the side. And what accidentally happened, and it was on the, let's say, the right side, and we were flying with the harbor on our right, and somebody there had fired something that hit the gun belt, and it hit this poor kid in the knee, shattered his knee. And this fellow said, I put a tourniquet on him, and he'd lost quite a bit of blood. And then he says, but that he was sick. He couldn't hold his dinner down, so to speak. And so I went down, redid. I had a little bit of first aid, but enough to do a tourniquet. So, but anyway, I could see he was very pale and so on. So we talked for the longest time, and then he gradually went to sleep, and that was it. You know, that was one evening. You know, and then I actually forgot that it went, and I guess I belong also to the Burma Bomber Group. So we were in on the prairies visiting Regina, and this girl came up to me and said, "Did you know my brother?" And I said, "Who was that?" And she's, they say you know, but you were with them. So I had to tell her the story. And they never knew. Nobody ever told her. So we had a little cry together. And that was kind of a nice evening.
I guess the last thing I really sort of interesting tidbit I remember was by the time we had got into Rangoon, the Army had taken Rangoon, we moved in very shortly after. And we were training to go into on a sea assault to Singapore. And I had a Scotch lad was a radio operator on my crew, and he happened to be in the radio shack doing duty for the wing one day in August. And I was passing time talking to him, and he got a signal saying that the order had come through that the Japanese had agreed to the Potsdam Agreement. Now, the first atomic bomb had been dropped a couple days before, so we knew, or we felt, things were pretty well winding down. But he got the signal that everything was to stand down until further word, that basically the war was over. The next signal that came through was that three Canadians, myself and two other chaps, a guy by the name of Matt Levitt, another chap by the name of Pettigrew, we were to report to Bombay to come home. Our war was over. Jock said he was going to keep the signal about the war being over, to keep a copy of it, because he said, "I always tell my grandchildren this was the most important signal of the war." And I pointed out to him, I said, "Jock, the really important was the one that came before, telling Corcoran to report to Bombay to go home." So that's the type of thing you remember.
battleship Missouri takes her place in Tokyo Bay for the official surrender of Japan, the end of the greatest war. The Japanese emissaries arrive. The surrender delegation coming aboard the Missouri is headed by Foreign Minister Shigemitsu. He has a wooden leg after an assassination attempt in Manchuria. In top hats and frock coats of diplomacy, they are like undertakers at their country's funeral. For the Japs, it's the end of a road of bandit conquest, invading China, forming alliance with Nazi Germany, taking advantage of the European war to strike in the Pacific, the Pearl Harbor sneak attack, and inhuman atrocities in war. The end of their road is utter defeat.
We knew that we were going back and we'd all get killed because we were going to lead 400,000 troops down into land in Malaya at two or three of the places along the coast there in the Malacca Straits. And we knew the Japs had about 1,000 suicide motor torpedo boats and about equal number of kamikazes. And in those narrow waters, we wouldn't have had a hope. So I'm glad they dropped the bomb.
Some people condemned Harry Truman for using it. Others didn't, because they thought at that time, they felt that the Americans would have won that war, but that it had cost them a lot more in lives, you see. It's the time they got to Japan. So the fact that they dropped them on Hiroshima and Nagasaki was a good move, I think.
I mean, I got to Singapore and I went ashore and I saw the Japanese for the first time. And I saw what they had done to the civilian population. I remember a man coming up to me and saying, "Could you mail a letter to me to my friends in India or somewhere?" And then I realized that there was no postal service. Postal service had not even started. And I said, "Okay, give me your letter. I'll probably put it in the ship's mail." And then he showed me his ring finger. And I asked him, "Why is your finger missing?" And he said, "I had a gold ring and the Japanese soldier wanted it and I couldn't take it out. So he cut my finger and took the ring."
I saw too many atrocities over there. Nasty ones. And they just killed for the sheer delight. You couldn't call them animals because animals only kill to eat.
But we were very angry with them because of the way they treated people. We were beginning to get information about their, the way they abused our guys and civilians, etc. And we were very angry with them.
If they got you, you knew your chances were pretty low of surviving.
Most of us that came out of the war scratch-free have been damn lucky, damn lucky.
Sixty years have passed since the end of World War II. For many Burma veterans, the scars from that time are still felt today.
For me, it cost me my 20s.
I had my boyhood and I went into manhood, just like that.
But sometimes I look back and I do feel that what an absolute wanton waste of men and material that war was.
We wonder now if we really did win the war, because things have changed so much. And the world that I'm living in today is not the world that we were fighting for.
I think as years went on and we found we were more, really realized how much we had been overlooked and ignored, it's sort of a nod on us a little bit.
The emphasis has always been on Europe, and that's because the regular military establishments in Canada were in Europe.
Europe, they understand, because it had a lot of publicity, but when it comes to the war in the Far East, they have no knowledge.
Most of us feel it's only in the last few months or the last year that efforts have been made to recognize that, yeah, there were Canadians in Burma.
Recently, the younger people seem to be taking a great deal of interest in what took place in World War II.
You know, it may be late, but better late than never. We have been acknowledged, at least.